we welcome you to worship today. And as we do so, we acknowledge that Calvary United Church stands on Treaty 6 territory. We pay our respects to our elders, both past and present, wherever we find ourselves this morning. We recommit to our status as an affirming ministry within the United Church of Canada and strive to be an open-minded, inclusive, and welcoming place of worship. It is our deepest hope that all people might feel at home in this space, and we give thanks to God for this Sabbath day, where we join our hearts and minds in prayer.
So we gather and we approach in faith. Life is God's gift to us, God's way of affirming the ongoing creative process out of which newness emerges, filled with potential and mystery and hope.
Worship is our gift to God.
Worship is our response to the love which embraces us, to the care which sustains us, and to the promises which guide us. In our worship service, we go into the realization that our Creator, Christ Spirit, truly wants us to be fully human, fully alive.
In worship, we express our gratitude for the world, our spiritual home, rejoicing in God's gift to us even as we seek to understand our response to that divine gift.
Thank you.
We offer now our confession. God of infinite patience and abiding grace, listen to us, we pray, as we offer to you our collective prayer of confession.
We are called to pray, but there are times when we speak the words while having little or no trust that our prayers accomplish anything. We are called to pray, but all too often our minds wander and our focus ends, lost in the wilderness of trivialities. We are called to pray, but often we ignore the needs of those around us and use our prayer to bolster our own self-interest. We are called to pray, but all too often we lose the sense of community in whose company we are praying.
In spite of our shortcomings, or perhaps even because of them, God hears us in the positives and in the negatives, and God still loves us.
So we open ourselves fully to God's forgiving love, trusting in God to receive our faults, to heal our wounds, and to form us into human beings who honor our God with love and joy. Thanks be to God. Amen.
We continue to follow some of our social distancing protocols, and so we offer to each other this morning the gift of peace in whatever way remains comfortable for us, either waving our hands or touching our elbows, all while maintaining a safe distance. Peace be with you. Greet one another with the peace of God.
The first reading is second from 2 Kings 5, 1 to 14. Naaman, commander of the army of the king of Aram, was a great man and in high favor with his master, because by him the Lord had given victory to Aram. The man, though a mighty warrior, suffered from a skin disease. Now the Arameans, on one of their raids, had taken a young girl captive from the land of Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my lord were with the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his skin disease." So Naaman went in and told his lord just what the girl from the land of Israel had said. And the king of Aram said, "Go then, and I will send along a letter to the king of Israel." He went, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of garments. He brought the letter to the king of Israel, which read, "When this letter reaches you, know that I have sent to you my servant Naaman, that you may cure him of his skin disease." When the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes and said, "Am I God to give death or life that this man sends to me a cure a man of his skin disease? Just look and see how he's trying to pick quarrel with me." But when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent a message to the king, "Why have you torn your clothes? Let him come to me, that he may learn that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman came with his horses and chariots and halted at the entrance of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a message to him saying, "Go wash in the Jordan 7 times and your flesh shall be restored and you shall be clean." But Naaman became angry and went away and saying, "I thought that for me he would surely come out and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, and would wave his hand over the spot and cure the skin disease. Arnit, Abana, and Papa, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean?" He turned and went away in a rage. But his servants approached him and said to him, "Father, if the prophet had commanded you to do something difficult, would you not have done it? How much more then, all he said to you was, 'Wash and be clean.'" So he went down and immersed himself 7 times in the Jordan, according to the word of the man and God. His flesh was restored, like the flesh of a young boy, and he was clean. Second reading is from Galatians. "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for you reap whatever you sow. If you sow you to your own flesh, you will reap corruption from the flesh. But if you sow to the Spirit, you will reap eternal life from the Spirit. So let us not grow weary in doing what is right, for we all will reap at harvest time if we do not give up. So then, whenever we have an opportunity, let us work for the good of all, and especially for those of the family of faith. See what large letters I make when I am writing in my own hand. It is those who want to make good showing in the flesh who try to compel you to be circumcised, only that they may not be persecuted for the cross of Christ. Even the circumcised do not themselves obey the law, but they want you to be circumcised so that they may boast about your flesh. May I never boast of anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For neither circumcision nor uncircumcision is anything, but a new creation is everything. As for those who will follow this rule, peace be upon them, and mercy and upon the Israel of God." Our psalm this morning is Psalm 30, Voices United, 757. Extol you, O God, for you have lifted me up.
You have not let my enemies triumph over me.
O God, my God, I cried to you for your help, and you restored my health.
You brought me back from the dead. You saved my life as I was going out to pray.
Let all your servants sing praises to you and give thanks to your holy name.
Your anger is but for a moment, but your kindness.
In my prosperity, I said,
"I shall never be shaken. Your favor, O God, has made me and his servants any strong mouth."
You turned your face away from me, and I was greatly dismayed. I called to you. I made my appeal.
A prophet is there in my death, in my going down to the grave.
Will the dust give you praise? Will it proclaim your faithfulness?
Hear, O God, and be gracious to me. O God, be my help.
You turned my mourning into dancing.
You stripped off my sackcloth and clothed me with your joy.
so that my heart will sing your praise without ceasing.
O God, my God, I will give thanks to you forever.
And the Gospel of Luke from chapter 10, verses 1 to 16. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them on ahead of him in pairs to every town and place where he himself intended to go. He said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few, and therefore ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go on your way. I am sending you out like lambs into the midst of wolves. Carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say peace to this house. And if a person of peace is there, your peace will rest on that person. But if not, it will return to you. Remain in the same house, eating and drinking whatever they provide, for the laborer deserves to be paid. Do not move about from house to house whenever you enter a town and its people. Welcome you, eat, and what is set before you, cure the sick who are there, and say to them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.' But whenever you enter a town and they do not welcome you, go out into its streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town that clings to our feet, we wipe off in protest against you.' Let know this: the kingdom of God has come near. I tell you, on that day it will be more tolerable for Sodom than for that town. Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the deeds of power done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repeated long ago, sitting in sackcloth and ashes. Indeed, at the judgment it will be more tolerable in Tyre and Sidon than for you. And you, Capernaum, will you be exalted to heaven? No, you will be brought down to Hades. Whatever listens to you listens to me. And whoever rejects you rejects me. And whoever rejects me rejects the one who sent me." Hear what the scriptures are saying to the church.
Thanks be to God. May the thoughts that I share with you this morning and the ways in which we interpret those thoughts into our faith journeys be acceptable to you, O God, our Creator, our Christ, our Spirit. Amen. So I want to start this morning by saying that you are going to hear words from my mouth that are do not often escape my mouth. I actually like what Paul wrote today. It's a miracle, I know. It's a miracle, yeah. My Bible study group knows it's a miracle. But I actually like what Paul says today. Except for the translation that Bob used, which says, God will not be mocked, which is a possible translation of the Greek word, but actually fooled is a better word. God will not be fooled. As in your parents saying to you when you come home with a story, you cannot fool me, I know there's more to this than what you're telling me. That is the context in which the Greek word describes what Paul is saying. Paul, I will not be fooled. And then Paul goes on to describe some of the things that Christians will face because of their faith in Jesus. And he's in that there is a warning, always, about being faithful, about being trusting, about being kind and gentle to each other, about being community. Indeed, I think that reading is actually the closest that Paul ever comes to what the Gospels speak to us about. Loving kindness and community and authenticity, an authentic faith that not only believes but lives out the faith in our day-to-day lives. And so I start off with that framework, an authentic faith. And I look at the Hebrew scripture reading for today, which is, I think, a fairly familiar reading to most of us if we've been regular attenders at church. It is the introduction of Elisha and his ministry as a prophet. We referred to Elisha last week because he was a student of Elijah and therefore was following Elijah around and learning things from Elijah. And he was there in the moment when all of the other prophets of Israel were gathered around Elijah, wondering which of them would succeed Elijah, and Elijah passes the rolled cloak that he wore onto Elisha as a sign that Elisha would be the prophet to follow Elijah. And Elijah disappears, and the 90, we never hear of them again. They too disappear. And we are left with Elisha, who is given the challenge of healing a guest of the king. When the king of Israel asks you to do something, you tend to do it. And so Elisha is called for and is given the task of healing someone. And Elisha eventually goes and does this task and gives the information to the guest, Nahum, and says, you know, basically what you have to do is you go to the river, you wash three times, etc., etc., etc. And the first response of the visitor is, of course, you've got to be kidding. I was expecting something momentous and large and greater than life, and you're telling me to soak in a dirty river? And it takes his servants to suggest to him that perhaps, maybe, if only, he would just try it out. Because he has nothing to lose, except maybe his dignity. So just try it out. And so he goes into the river and does the three times bathing, and he is cured. I think his reaction to Elisha is often the reaction people have when they begin a faith journey. Is this all there is? Is it as simple as praying and being kind to each other and loving kindness and gentleness? Surely being faithful is bigger than that. And yet over and over again, we are reminded that it is in the little gestures that faith is conveyed. It is in the phone call that says, "How are you today?" It is in the surprise card that arrives in the mail saying, "I've been thinking about you." It is when we gather for coffee and have conversation, which we hope to do eventually soon again here at Wesley. But I've been popping into the Bison once in a while in the mornings after I drop Nicholas off. And I really am cherishing again that contact with other people whom I know and the sharing of stories. It's nothing big. It's not dramatic. But it is part of who we are as children of God. And I think also of Elisha following Elijah and all of the magical, powerful things that Elijah did, and how people are looking at Elisha and saying, "Okay, why are you not doing the same? How can you call yourself a prophet when you're not anything like Elijah?" And I think about ministers, for some reason, following other ministers, especially well-liked, beloved ministers. And I recall this movie that I watched about 20 years ago, called Italian for Beginners. And it was set in Denmark with a Lutheran community being in Denmark. And a new young minister arrived at the Lutheran parish to serve that parish following the retirement of the longtime minister there, who chose to stay and would sit up in the balcony and heckle the new young minister, which would never happen in the United Church, of course. We're much too polite for that. But there he is, up there heckling. There's the young fellow, new to ministry, doing his best. How to solve this problem of not being like the previous minister. He joins a rugby team. Rugby is sort of a European form of football, for those of you who don't know what rugby is. I had to play it in high school. I hated it. Not much of a football player either. One of the reasons I hated it is because rugby players had to be solid. And I was skinny. So you can imagine what happened to me when two rugby players came on either side of me. But he makes friends, this young minister, makes friends with these rugby players to the point where they come to church. Can you guess the plot? Two of them go up into the balcony when the retired minister does his thing and sit on either side of him and carry him out of the church. This is how you solve being different from your predecessor. Elisha solved it by doing his own thing and getting someone to follow it and succeeding. Paul followed Jesus, and that's something that I had to remind myself of this week as I thought about the story. Paul followed Jesus. What an incredibly hard act to follow. And so Paul is doing his best to kind of organize some of the thoughts that Jesus just sprays around as he wanders with his disciples. To some degree, Paul is trying to codify what Jesus has said. And yes, I don't always agree with what Paul decides is important, but I have to admit this morning that I at least can admire him for trying. For trying his best to make some order and discipline for a new faith community. And so you and I in the United Church, we follow this kind of balance. A balance of order, but also of breaking outside the lines and doing things differently. And over the decades, we have often been chastised because we are, quote unquote, different. We ordained a woman long before anyone else, any other denomination ordained a woman. Although we didn't ordain all that many until the recent era. We became an open, welcoming community to all people, regardless of identities, gender, sexual preferences. We took what Jesus said about love and what Paul codified in some ways into a community, and then we broadened all of that. In a sense, we did exactly what the prophets had been doing, what Jesus was doing, what Paul was doing. We recreated ourselves in our own understanding of the image of God. Male and female, transgendered, heterosexual and gay, whatever the terms are, we recreated because of love. Because at the foundation of who we are and whose we are is the one who says, I love you always. And we, as a community, reflect that love. So we take the example of the prophets. We take the gospel stories. We take the ways in which Paul and others interpret those stories to form a new faith community. And we ourselves listen and learn and implement and grow. So it is. So it has been throughout the history of our faith communities. And so it remains, because we are children of God. Amen. Let us pray. Creator Christ Spirit, we truly are proud of our faith heritage, a heritage that stretches across the centuries to the days of Adam and Eve, Noah, Moses, Elijah, and Elisha. We give thanks for all of the lessons that these and others have taught the folk in their generation, lessons that we absorb yet again as we listen anew to each cycle of readings. In the quiet stillness of this moment, we rest in the embrace of your listening ear. We acknowledge the pathways of our collective journeys that bring us to this place and this time, and we are grateful for your guidance along our respective and collective journeys. Today, we acknowledge that you truly are God of community. You are God of the lonely back alleys and the teeming marketplaces. You are God of the quiet pastures and the open rangelands, of villages and towns and urban centers. You are God of the places where there is need, nudging us to be your followers wherever others seek love, compassion, and support. We see you at work in the minds of researchers, formulating vaccines and seeking cures for the world's diseases. We hear you through the tears of children craving life-giving water and nurturing food. You are reflected in the eyes and hands of caregivers administering to those with unique needs. We hear your presence in the first cry of a newborn child. In all these experiences, our heart widens at the knowledge of the gifts each of us has to offer to others. God of peace and love, we enjoy living in a land overflowing with the bountiful gifts of clean water, pure air, and abundant growth of nurturing food. Give us here the courage and the grace to listen to the needs of others who do not have access to the natural resources we take for granted. Encourage us to persist in our efforts to make a difference, offering our hearts, our hands, our minds, and our voices to address injustice, intolerance, marginalization, greed, and poverty within the wider community that is our shared world. May we truly be instruments of peace in a world where some have had so many impediments when it comes to living fully and completely in the love you have for all creation. May we understand ourselves truly as stewards of the world's resources as we pursue the vision of a just and peaceable global village. In your abundant and abiding love, we offer our prayers. We pray this day especially for those families in our community who are grieving. We pray with those families who are with a loved one as this one loved one reaches the close of the end of her life. We pray for parents of newborns and for parents of additional children as they create family. We pray for your children in the world around us, all your children, that they would know your light and your love. And we close, as always, with words that are familiar to us, opening with whatever term we feel comfortable. Our Creator, Christ Spirit, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. May you, O God, the Holy Three-in-One whom we worship, walk with us as we travel this road called life.
And throughout our daily living, may we feel your light, O God, and your loving, tender embrace as we move from this sanctuary to live our faith within the daily challenges and opportunities in the world around us.
And to this all God's children say,
Amen.
Amen.